the stain.
Tom Thomas, what's going on? If you really want to watch TV, then you gotta turn it on first.
I'm not watching it, I'm looking at my reflection. I'm working on a self-portrait.
And which shelf will you be painting in your shelf-portrait?
It's not a shelf-portrait, it's called a self-portrait. It's when an artist draws or paints a picture of himself.
Of himself? Ha! You think you've got muscles like the superhero I see here on this paper?
How can I see exactly what my muscles look like? And anyway, let the artist do his work.
Tom Thomas, your shirt! There's a spot!
Oh, no!
Wipe it off, quickly!
It's even worse, so now what?
What we really need is Masia.
Ordinary dirt can be cleaned off with a brush or washed off with water. But there are stains that are not that easy to get rid of. Stains from fruit need to be soaked in hot water first. Blood stains, on the other hand, should never be washed in hot water. You can clean stains from paint or rust as well. Only for those, you'll need to use a special stain remover. But stain removers should only be used with the help of a parent or other adult that knows how to use them safely.
Hey, I know a great way to do it! What do you use to get rid of pencil marks?
An eraser. Only this shirt isn't paper.
And so what? Let's try it. What's the harm?
Now I've got three colors to get off.
New idea! We should paint over it with this correction pen.
With whiteout?
Yeah!
That was a bad idea.
Now I got it. You have to use some water.
The wash should be better, don't you think?
No, you can't wash whites with colors. And you've got a white shirt with colors all over it.
Then how about if we try some more water?
How much more can you use?
Any more ideas?
You know what? It's possible we did something wrong.
Everything you did was wrong. You should have used a spot remover to clean off that stain.
A spot remover? No way!
Oh, take a look at it, Simka. I think it's marvelous. They painted that white shirt so nicely.
Tula is Simka's best friend. She's very tall, almost as tall as Papoose. Yeah, she's the tallest one in her class. And she's strong, too. Tula loves to laugh, and she does it louder than everybody. That's just the way she is. Cheerful and kind. Ready to help anyone who needs it, and making sure her friends are getting along. Of course, I don't like that she treats me like a baby, especially since she's the one that's a scaredy cat. She can even get scared of a cute little spider. And she believes in all sorts of silly superstitions and horoscopes. Tula will believe anything you tell her, which is really great because it makes it so easy to play tricks on her. But she takes it all in good fun. That's because she's Tula.
It was on purpose, wasn't it?
Well, yeah.
Tom Thomas, no! Your mom will punish you for just one of them, and now you're gonna make more stains?
Don't worry, Nolik. I forgot that this is an old shirt, and I'm allowed to get it all dirty if I want.
And I tried so hard to clean it.
Put another spot there, and over here. One in the middle, and a line over there. Splendid! That looks great! And how about down there?
Wow! It's like fireworks!
Splendid! There's a name for this style of painting, and properly speaking, it's an abstract painting. They have lots of lines and spots, and everyone sees whatever they want in them. Yeah, look! A golden ball by the river!
And there's Tom Thomas with an F on his report card!
Tom Thomas, what did you do to your room? And your shirt?
You know what they call it? It's, abstract art.
There's something good in it. I like it. Abstract art. Isn't it great?
Ah, my little artist.
The wires.
Quiet down. Get ready for your lesson.
Be quiet.
Quiet down, please. Oh, it's so hot here. In today's class, we'll learn about...
What was that, huh?
It must have been an earthquake.
Yeah, it was an earthquake. Hooray!
Sorry there, Professor. Ooh, I have to find an outlet so I can plug in this fan. Ooh, it feels terribly hot.
It sure does. Well, keep looking. You'll find one. Now then, where was I? Oh, right. Today...
No, it's impossible. In this whole laboratory, there isn't one free outlet. Look at this.
Just pull out one of these wires, and then you'll have a free outlet.
I can't. I fear I could pull out a plug for something important. Volt himself would get all tangled up in these wires. Whew.
Don't worry about it, Professor Eugenius. We'll find a free outlet for you.
That's right, my colleague. A cup of tea will do you good, so just go relax.
Thank you, my colleague. And as always, I'm eternally grateful.
Fixies have opened schools for their children in all sorts of different places, like factories, stores, and warehouses. Anywhere where there's lots of machines and appliances and places to hide from humans. And this is where we hold our school, right here inside the laboratory of Professor Eugenius. It's a fantastic place for me to hold class. Every day, new devices, materials, toys, and even food are brought here for examination. And there are lots of scientific devices and tools to study here as well. But most importantly, we never need to hide from the head of the laboratory. Because my colleague, Professor Eugenius, is someone I'm proud to call a friend. He loves Fixies, helps us anytime we need, and will never let our secret out.
What should we do first?
We have to start out with pulling apart these wires.
That'll take a second.
Over here!
No, here! Nolik, come help!
Let's do this! Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, just one more time!
Stop it! I can't get out! Loosen the wires!
We need to pull out this one!
Stop this nonsense, will ya?
Thank you, Digit.
Tiddish. Well, the way I see it, in order to get the knot out that's over here, we need to expand the loop that's over there. And then push that wire through it. And then do it again from the other end. That's it. Very good, girls.
Hey!
Now pull it hard. Perfect.
Hey, check it out. This green wire up here isn't plugged into anything.
Then no one's using it. So that means we should go and pull it out from the outlet.
Got it.
Vera, here's another wire that isn't plugged in.
I found another wire no one's using. Oh, I mean, Simka and I found it together. Nolik, why are you so upset?
Because you guys are doing all the work.
How about this wire? Nobody's checked it yet.
Really? Oh, wow!
What? Did you find some treasure, Nolik?
Uh-huh. There are 6 free outlets under here.
Great! Now Professor Eugenius can plug in his fan and his kettle and even his soldering iron.
To get electricity to a device that doesn't use batteries, you need to plug a pair of wires into an outlet. But it's important not to let the wires touch one another, or the electricity can burn them out. That's why wires are covered in plastic or rubber, so the electricity won't pass from one wire to the other, or to us when we touch them. So always be very careful with wires, and never, ever touch a bare wire. You could get killed by the electric shock.
Oh, what would I do without my wonderful friends? Thank you. sorry. I wanted to... I should go.
Go ahead. That's a great idea. And we'll start our class. What were we talking about?
All about wires.
Well, it looks like our class is over.
Time to go play.
Friction.
Thomas, that door of yours squeaks terribly.
Yeah, and it's not easy to open either.
Well, that's because the hinges are rubbing. That's why your door is not working right.
How can I fix it?
Just reduce the amount of friction.
How?
With some oil on the hinges. I can do it for you because I've got a pack-a-mat.
All right.
Simka, can I help you?
Sure you can. Wear the pack-a-mat, all right?
Friction is the force that tries to stop something from sliding or rubbing smoothly against something else. Rubbing can make things wear out quickly if there's a lot of friction. If you want less friction, you need to put something on the parts that rub against each other, like oil. There are special kinds of grease used to keep clocks and wheels turning smoothly. And for skis, a special kind of wax can be used to make them go even faster. That's it. Now the top hinge. It's all done. Go ahead and check how it's working.
It's not squeaking.
I told ya.
You guys are the best. I gotta go.
Go where?
I'm gonna go sledding.
Maybe you'll take me with you?
Sorry, Nolik. You don't have a sled to ride on. I'll see you later. Simka, should I grease the saucer?
What for? It'll slide down the hill just the way it is.
Ah, okay then.
Wait here for me, Nolik. I'll be back real soon with a surprise for you.
Yeah, oil slippery. I know what I'll do.
Wow! Talk about no friction!
Are you all right? Just stay where you are. I'll be right there. Papoose!
Papoose! Help us, please!
Who called for me? Help is on the way!
Hey, what are you up to?
Grandpa, stay away from here!
You'll fall over!
Huh? What did you say?
Stay where you are!
What happened here?
I poured some oil on the table.
Why'd you do that?
To reduce friction.
That's brilliant.
Nobody move. I know exactly what to do.
The problem you had with the friction.
I want to see all of this oil gone in 5 minutes.
Engineers are in a constant battle with the force of friction. They want less friction so that cars will run faster and their parts will wear out less quickly. But just imagine what the world would be like if all of a sudden there was simply no friction at all. Everything would start slipping out of our hands and falling off the table. Knots would untie themselves, and that's not the half of it. Cars wouldn't be able to run without friction either. Wheels would spin around and around in one place, unable to grab onto the road. We wouldn't even be able to walk. Because when we walk, we move forward by pushing off the ground with our feet. And how can we do that without friction? We can't. So now I think you can see why it's not so bad to have a little bit of friction in our lives.
Whew! We cleaned it.
But it's still so stinky.
Nolik, I completely forgot. I promised you a surprise. Look!
What is it?
I'm
made you your very own saucer for sledding.
Oh, that's great! Only, what good is this thing without snow?
Nolik, hey! Look what I've got for you!
Snow?
Yeah.
Is it real snow? Really?
Yep. Now you've got your very own hill to sled on.
This is great! What an awesome surprise!
And you don't need oil to make it go quickly.
Yee-haw!
The vent. Tom Thomas! Tom Thomas!
Okay.
Simka, Tula, check it out. It's pretty, isn't it?
Oh, splendid. It's nothing but a trinket. It's completely useless.
Useless? Look how well it matches my hair clip.
Useful things are the kinds of things you truly need. For instance, like this rope ladder I've got.
It's splendid. And where do you plan on climbing with this thing? Now this mirror here is both useful and pretty.
Oh, how splendid. Tula, you say everything is splendid. Well, here's something super splendid that I bet you don't have.
Oh, what is it?
It's a mechanical super claw.
It must be just perfect for scratching your back. Now look what I have. A photograph of Vector. And he signed it for me, too.
Are you sure that's Vector?
You've got a photo of the bravest Fixie on the face of the entire planet?
Yeah, and the most beautiful.
Is it him for sure? No way. Let me take a look.
Uh-uh. You'll smudge it.
You've been fooled.
No.
Yes.
Jealous?
You are.
My photo!
Oh, no! What was that?
A draft.
This is completely your fault.
It's not my fault. It's your fault for bragging so much.
Please, girls, stop fighting. Let's go find it.
To lose a picture signed by the most famous Fixie ever.
It will be horrible when that picture of a Fixie is found by humans.
So where could it be?
I know how we can find it.
Exactly. We'll blow a bubble and watch which way it goes as it floats away. We'll follow it and find your picture.
Do you know why you can blow bubbles out of soapy water? At the surface of any liquid, there's an invisible film that is very thin but very strong. If you want to see it for yourself, fill up a glass with water all the way to the very top. Now you need to take a coin and carefully drop it into the water sideways. Then drop in another coin, and another, and another. You'll see that the water doesn't pour out, but rises up and forms a hump. That's because the water at the top sticks together. Why? Because of a force called surface tension. Thanks to surface tension, water can form drops. It also helps us blow soap bubbles, because when we add soap into the water, the film gets even stronger, but still not strong enough to stop the bubbles from bursting.
Okay, it's ready. Now we need to blow.
Do it together. And...
I don't think this way's gonna work. Look, it's flying!
We did it!
The vent! Of course! Why didn't I think of that before? Have you ever seen holes in the bathroom or kitchen that are covered with grids? Well, those are called vents. And behind the vent is a long pipe called an air duct. Unpleasant odors and musty air can be forced into the ducts and sent out of the house. And if you want that old, stale air to leave the house even faster, open a window and let in some of the fresh air from outside. Keep the air in your home as fresh as it can be. Hey, take a look! It got stuck over there!
Get it before it flies away!
your mechanical claw.
And your fantastic ladder.
Then here you go. A present for you.
Oh, thanks. It's just great.
And I want to give you this.
Oh, gee. It's just splendid.
Simka, are you here? Huh. What you got there, Simka?
A little mirror. It's pretty, don't you think?
Oh, you girls. You're all the same.
The level.
Tom Thomas, I'm really sorry. The movie this weekend, I have to cancel.
You do?
I need to go to Africa for work. I leave tomorrow.
Oh, cool. You think I could go with you?
To Africa? Can you even find it on the map?
Africa. Here we go.
Mm-hmm. No, you're still too little. When you grow as tall as the top of Africa, then I'll take you with me.
Here, there,
Tom Thomas, what you doing down there?
I want to know if I'm as tall as the top of Africa, or not.
Well, do you know your height?
Uh-uh.
Okay, then let's measure you and mark how tall you are. You just need to hold the book, all right?
Simka, how do we measure what's higher? The top of Africa or this line over here?
It's a tough one. We need a piece of flexible, clear tubing. Oh, I can get it for you. I know where it is. And we'll build a simple tool to find out the answer. It's called a water level. Let's do an experiment. First, we'll pour water into two bottles. A little bit more into one, and a little less into the other. Now we'll connect them with a tube so that the water can flow between them. You see? The water flows and flows. And then it stops. It stops when there's the same amount of water inside of both bottles. And if we do this with a simple tube, it becomes a useful tool called a water level, in which the water on both sides is always the same height.
I'm gonna watch the water level on this end, all right?
Be careful how you lift it, or the water can get out. Nolik, what's going on?
The water inside the tube is even with the line.
There you go, Tom Thomas. Where the water is right now is how tall you are.
And?
Well, it looks like Tom Thomas isn't quite tall enough for Africa.
What if we hold the tube a little higher?
You can try if you want, but the water's gonna stay where it is. The water level on your side always stays the same as on the other side.
I'm not getting that tall for a while yet.
And what if we just lower the map a little?
That wouldn't be honest.
But it would be clever.
There are a lot of great proverbs, but my favorite one is measure twice, cut once. And to measure things right, you need measuring tools. The simplest one is a ruler. With its help, we can find out the length of an object. A watch can tell us how much time has passed. A speedometer shows us how fast we are moving, like in a car or on a bike. An electric meter keeps track of how much electricity we are using. A decibel meter can tell us who is screaming or stomping louder. And a beam compass is used to accurately measure the size of a coin or a hole. We couldn't get by without wonderful tools like these. If we didn't measure the things we are building carefully, everything around us would just come loose and fall apart. Uh-oh.
Dad! Dad! Look, Dad!
That's strange. Looks like you are a little taller.
Does that mean you'll take me with you?
Yeah. Are you ready?
Yay!
But everyone who goes to Africa has to get vaccinated. You're okay with that, aren't you?
I need vaccinations to go. Are you sure?
Yeah, there's one against malaria, tsetse fly, crocodile bites. Altogether, there are 10 shots.
10 shots?
Yeah, 10.
Oh. Dad, you know, I was joking. After you left the room, I moved the map down.
Okay, I see. And I was joking about all those shots you need.
What? You mean you don't need to get shots?
You gotta, just not 10.
So how many? 9 of them. There's no vaccination anywhere to stop a crocodile from biting you.
The team.
The first period is almost over. Tom Thomas's team is leading 2-0. There's no getting around the difference in class.
Simka, pass to me!
Goal! 3-0. And that's the end of the period. Time for the teams to take a break.
This isn't a fair game.
There's 6 of these guys and only 2 of us.
Go ahead and call your classmates. I'll still outscore you.
You sure about that?
Uh-huh.
Well, Tom Thomas, you asked for it.
Young Fixies take classes and study just like human kids. But Fixie schools are quite a bit different than schools for people. To begin with, there are no more than 10 students in a room. In Simka's class, for instance, there are 6, and the children don't study in one place. On one day, the lesson could be inside a refrigerator, the next day in a computer, and the day after that in a vacuum cleaner. This is the best way for Fixies to learn all about them and put their new knowledge to the test. But the most important thing is that they have to learn to work as a team and help each other. Stronger Fixies helping weaker ones, and older Fixies helping younger ones. This is a must for Fixies, because appliances are so very big that if we didn't work as a team, we little Fixies could never get by.
As the second period is about to begin, our full team comes to the ice!
Huh?
Introducing the engine of our class,
my motor's roaring!
And now the brains of our class, Digit!
Okay, what's the score?
Now here is the spirit of our class, Tula!
Could I be our goalie?
And here she is, the face of our class, Verda!
And oh, what a cute one.
So you want to quit, Tom Thomas?
I'm not afraid of you.
Nolik, pass!
Shoo!
I'm calculating the angle to use.
Oh! Oops!
Pass it quick! Ugh. Quit sleeping!
If you're gonna scream at me, I'm not going to play at all.
Wow, that's some team you got there. Six nothing! It's a blowout! Now the intermission before the final period.
We're missing something here.
I can tell you what.
You mean confidence?
Calculations?
Elegance?
I know, speed.
What's missing here's teamwork.
Simka, you're right. It's one for all and all for one.
Then here's what we're gonna do.
We got it! Check, don't lose control. A line change on the fly. The puck is zooming towards the goal to score and break the tie.
It's one for all and all for one. Great teamwork is a must. Let's go and show them how it's done. This game was made for us.
Hockey's our game. Hockey's our game. Hockey's our game. Hockey's our game.
get creamed like that?
'Cause you're by yourself here, and we are a team!
Nolik cue. Whoop!
Tom Thomas, you'll be late for school if you don't stop.
School? Don't you worry.
What's he breaking this time?
This time, nothing. He's solving a Rubik's Cube, Nolik.
Whose cube is it?
The Rubik's Cube is the most popular puzzle game in the whole world. It was invented by Professor Rubik from Hungary. A cube has 6 sides on it. And on a Rubik's Cube, each of these sides has 9 squares that are all the same color. You start by mixing up the colors. To solve a Rubik's Cube, you have to turn the pieces, and you keep turning and turning them until each side is one solid color again. For instance, red or yellow or light blue.
That's nothing. Hey, Tom Thomas, how long have you been messing around with this cube already?
It's been 3 whole days of turning.
3 whole days? We could solve that puzzle in 5 minutes, now couldn't we, Simka?
Oh, really? Then go right ahead. I'm off to school.
Well, you ready to show Tom Thomas who's boss?
Just count me out.
Hey, I thought you said Rubik's Cubes are easy to solve.
I never said anything like that. This problem is all yours, Mr. Bragger.
All right, I'll figure it out myself. Ugh. Ugh.
Hey, Nolik, looks like you've got a problem.
Oh, hi, Fire. No, I'm good. Just solving this Rubik's Cube.
Yeah? Can I do it with you?
What, you can do it?
Of course I can. How hard can it be?
You'll see for yourself. Try getting all the red squares on one side.
Piece of cake. Now hold it tight.
Great, I'm with you. Whoa!
Like that?
Class. And what about this side?
What?
This side's gotta be all blue.
Okay, let's go fix it. There, like you wanted.
Now what happened to the red side?
Huh?
Simka was telling me that on each side there has to be one color.
Oh, like Simka'd be able to do this?
Simka can do it all.
Well, if Simka can, then I can too.
Oh! Fire! You busted the cube!
I didn't bust it. I took it apart. Now let's put it together. And not just any way, but the right way.
Puzzles are toys, games, or problems that force you to use your mind in a clever and creative way. Take a labyrinth, for example. In a labyrinth, the challenge is to find the one way to get through a series of tangled corridors. Another fun puzzle is a jigsaw puzzle. Here, you need to put together a picture out of many little pieces. For this, you need to not only pay attention, but be patient. And there are all sorts of puzzles for the computer. One popular computer puzzle is Tetris. In Tetris, different shapes fall down the screen, and you have to think quickly to get them to line up into rows. And solving puzzles isn't only a great activity for people. It's good for Fixies, too. That's right. Puzzles are like exercises for our brain.
There. All done.
Nolik, you better hurry, because Tom Thomas is on his way home.
Hi there, Simka.
Just take a look at this. We did it.
I can't believe it. How?
Oh, it was a piece of cake.
Simka, Nolik, I'm back.
Well, I'm out of here.
Ciao.
Woohee!
Wow, you really solved it.
It was Nolik.
Nolik, you are cool. So how?
You see, first you break it apart into all of the pieces, and then you put it all back together.
No!
That's cheating. You gotta turn the cube, not take it apart. Now I'll solve this cube, honestly.
I don't think you can.
Why are you so sure?
I glued it together.
How come?
So you'll stop straining your brain with it. Now the cube will always be the right way.
But if it doesn't turn, it's not a Rubik's cube.
Well, yeah. Now it's a Nolik's cube, right?
The crowbar.
Everything's fine here, too. I wish something would break for a change. It's already been a week and nothing's broken in here.
Stop worrying. Everything breaks at some point.
Well, nothing seems to ever break inside of this house.
That's because we take such good care of it.
No, Masya, it's boring with no real work to do. We should move somewhere else.
When Fixies graduate from school, they must choose the place where they want to work. Some will work at factories, and some on ships, and some in theaters, and some in hospitals, too. Fixies are needed everywhere. Now, Fixie families with children like to choose places that are a bit quieter. Usually, they'll settle inside of people's houses. It's not too noisy there, like in a factory, but there's still plenty of work to do. They need to check on appliances like computers, vacuum cleaners, telephones, irons, and washing machines. And Fixies always try their best. They just love being busy with work. And so if there's nothing broken in the house, Fixie families will move to a new place where there's much more work to be done.
Nolik, did you hear that?
I don't want to move anywhere.
But think about the kids, dear. They've got their school and friends here.
Do you like this friend of theirs? A human kid playing with Fixie kids. You know as well as I that it's just not right. All right, then. If nothing's broken down before the end of the day, that's all. We gotta move.
Oh, no, I can't. Tom Thomas comes home the day after tomorrow, and we'd be gone by then.
Pull yourself together.
And I won't see him anymore at all?
Nolik, I have an idea.
What idea?
If something happens to break down before the end of the day, then we're not moving.
But what if nothing breaks?
Calm down. We're gonna make sure of it.
Simka, you're a genius. But how can we make sure of it?
We're going to use a crowbar. A crowbar is powerful and simple. It's nothing more than a heavy metal bar with either sharp or flat ends. It can be very helpful for breaking through concrete or ice. It can also be used as a lever to root out a tree stump or move a boulder. If one end of the bar has a claw cut into it, then it's good for pulling out nails. Yes, sometimes the simplest tools are the most powerful ones.
Do we have that tool?
We've got our pack-a-mat. And it's got everything.
Yay!
In gadgets and devices, our work will never end. Appliances are fickle. They need a loyal friend.
At morning, noon, and midnight of every single day. When there is an emergency, you know we're on our way. One, two, three, inside will be
doing. No, you're not.
Now I'm confused.
First off, whatever you break's gotta look like it broke all by itself.
Oh, I gotcha.
And second, you gotta break it in some way that can be fixed later.
Did someone say something needs fixing? Or am I hearing things?
Papas, we just found out that the television's broken down.
Are you sure?
Yeah. And one of the keys on the keyboard is stuck.
For real?
For real. And the clock's not running either.
Oh-ho! Masya, our life is getting back on the right track.
Should we fix them?
Yeah, what else? We are the Fixies.
We live to keep on working, and work for us is fun. So we'll just keep on working, cause our work's never done. And deep inside of gadgets, if you look when it's dark, you might just see us face around like multicolored sparks.
One, two, three.
Tadish!
Inside will be
Tadish!
To fix what's wrong.
Tadish!
Till it runs strong. One, two, three.
Tadish!
Inside will be
Tadish!
All day and night.
Tadish!
We fix things right.
Tadish!
Tadish!
Oh, that was a lot to do.
You'd almost think that somebody broke it on purpose.
Well, we didn't do it.
It broke by itself.
Yeah, this apartment still needs a lot of work. We shouldn't move anywhere. I like it here.
So do I.
It's the best.
See, we don't need to go anywhere.
The Kaleidoscope.
Tom Thomas, when are you gonna give me a peek at your new ball? I just can't wait.
I told you, you can see it as soon as I hang it up. You're not peeking, are you?
No, I'm not.
Oh!
So can I look at it now?
Sure, take a look.
Which one?
This one.
You broke it! It's okay, don't be sad. I know what to do. Tom Thomas, look inside the kaleidoscope.
What for? I looked already.
Come on, there's something in there I'm sure you've never seen.
Whoa.
Cool, isn't it?
What is it?
It's my own invention, a pirate kaleidoscope. Glass, right?
Uh-huh. It's great. I really like it.
Tom Thomas, hi there. I heard that you got a pretty ball to hang on the tree.
Shh.
Can I see it?
It's right there.
Where?
There.
No! Oh, that's just terrible.
Why'd you do that, Simka? Come on now. I just cheered him up.
How? Tell me.
With the kaleidoscope, remember what Grandpa's taught us?
Do you know what makes a kaleidoscope have such beautiful patterns? Ah, it's because pieces of multicolored glass are tumbling around in there. And it's also because it has mirrors inside. Usually there are three of them, and they are arranged facing each other. That way, each piece of glass makes many, many reflections that create the kaleidoscope's beautiful symmetrical patterns. By the way, you can put just about anything you want inside a kaleidoscope, and each different thing makes its own special pattern. Yes, there are all kinds of kaleidoscopes, some with buttons inside, some with flowers, and even some that are filled with insects. Once, a very rich man had a kaleidoscope made with precious stones inside. Yeah, it probably wouldn't have been nearly as beautiful if he had just filled it up with money.
Thomas, look inside the kaleidoscope.
I already saw it. It's pirates.
Nah, it's not about pirates.
We changed it. Go on. Look and see.
Wow.
You like it?
A lot. Hey, what did you put in there?
A few pieces of the ball that you smashed.
It's even better for Christmas, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Aw. That didn't work at all.
Merry Christmas!
We came to take a look at that splendid new Christmas.
Oh, what's wrong?
Ugh, don't even ask us that. I've got it! Tom Thomas!
What?
Look inside the kaleidoscope!
Again? I don't want to.
And I'm telling you, you've got to.
Fine. Cool, yeah!
Merry Christmas!
Thanks so much.
Now don't you feel good again?
Yeah, it's really something.
And you're the first human in the world that's ever seen it. How about that? Turn it! It's great, isn't it?
Wondrous designs that tickle the eye in the kaleidoscope.
Petals that glisten and gleam.
everybody. Tom Thomas, I came to look for myself at that beautiful Christmas.
Shh. It's okay. What's more important, having such awesome friends or some ball hanging from a tree?
The doorbell.
Nolik! Nolik, what are you doing here?
Just whistling a tune.
Are you gonna whistle that tune the whole time Tom Thomas is away? He just left with his parents for a week, and we've got guests coming, remember?
What guests?
I invited everybody.
The class?
Yes, class.
Are they sleeping in there or what, huh?
First they invite us, and now they don't want to let us in?
I'll share the present with you, then.
Fire. Maybe you'll get it to work now.
When they get here, they'll ring the bell.
How come? Why don't they just do what they always do and climb through the keyhole?
No way. It's not that simple, Nolik. Today they're our guests.
Ah.
The guests ring the bell, and the hosts let them in the house.
It doesn't ring.
You think the doorbell's broken?
I say we go fix it.
Before we fix anything, we need to know what went wrong with it.
First we'll fix it, and then we'll know what it was.
Back in the olden days, people would hang a bell over their doors with a string, and guests would tug on it to make it ring. Today, doorbells are electric, and they make all sorts of different sounds. Some buzz, some ring, and some even chirp like birds. The sound comes from a box inside the house called a chime. To make the chime ring, you push a button that's located outside. The button works just like a light switch, but instead of turning on light, it turns on sound.
Verda, will you join me? Whoop!
I gotta think about this. Yeah.
Simka! You think your guests are gonna come at all?
Simka!
Tula?
Hey!
The doorbell doesn't work! It must be broken!
That's odd. We heard it ring this morning. Nolik, let's go! First, we'll examine the contacts. Yep, good and tight. Okay, let's check the speaker. Speaker's fine.
Maybe the electronics are the problem.
And what if we disconnect these wires and switch them?
What'll that do?
We'll know soon enough. You know what? Why don't we connect the wires straight together?
Isn't that dangerous?
We'll find out. Don't worry. Nothing happened yet.
Fire. He's the engine of our class. He's the fastest, the nimblest, and the bravest. Fire never sits still for a second, and he's always looking for adventure. New ideas just burn in his head. And that's why his name is Fire. But not all of his ideas are very good, so he's constantly getting bumps and bruises. He just can't help getting carried away. If he's burning with an idea, he can even forget about his classes at school. Grampus punishes him for that. But it doesn't seem to bother Fire, because some new plan will pop into his head the very next second. To be honest, Fire's my favorite out of all the boys in our class. It's sure never boring when he's around.
Hey, you down there. I figured out why it's not working.
So what's the reason?
There's no electricity in the whole house. So that's why the bell isn't working.
And what? We can't visit like real guests do until the electricity comes back? And when will it work again?
Don't know. It could possibly take hours, guys.
Oh, it's working again! Ah!
Enough ringing! Hey, Fire, quit fooling around!
He's not fooling around!
It's not me, see?
Then who's ringing it?
I don't know! Well, I know. The doorbell's ringing because Fire connected the wires together.
True, but I'll fix that right now.
Ha! Your guests sure are noisy!
crazy.
Yeah, thank goodness the humans aren't home right now.
Hello?
Hello there, dear guests. Let yourself into our home through the keyhole.
So, should we go in?
Go where?
Go inside.
Nah, that's not how guests act.
So what do we do?
Real guests always ring the bell. Okay, hold me tight.
Tubes. Today's lesson will be on pipes and tubing. Right here inside of this laboratory, you can see them all over. Look, over there, and there. Some more over there, and there's another one. So, who can tell me some different uses for tubes? Digit!
They're used in plumbing, to carry the water.
Nolik, in school we don't give an answer without being called on. Digit!
You can...
And for carrying waste.
I am talking to Digit now.
Gas goes through pipes too.
Stop interrupting us!
And don't forget about smoke in a smokestack.
Nolik, that's just rude behavior. Out, right now! All right.
And a shower hose. That's also a tube, right?
I told you to get out.
Yikes! And a vacuum cleaner's got one, too. And those spyglasses that pirates use when they're sailing.
Hey, what do you say we all go and sneak out of here?
Great idea. Let him call out to himself.
Shh.
And a trumpet's a tube that you blow through.
Is my younger brother. There's a lot he still doesn't know, but that doesn't stop him from getting involved in things he probably shouldn't. Unfortunately, that can get him into trouble. So, every once in a while, me or my parents have to rescue him. No, I wouldn't call Nolik a pest. He's just a bit curious. That's why he broke the number one Fixie rule, hide from humans. Nolik's the one who first became friends with Tom Thomas. Well, I was there too, but Nolik started it. Actually, first it was Grampus. Many years ago, he befriended Professor Eugenius. And after that, the professor let us have our school in his laboratory. So it turns out that Nolik is just like his grandfather.
Digit, go on then.
Tubes are,
Just look at all the tubes in here! There's rubber ones and glass ones that are curvy! Oh yeah! Pens! Parts of them are tubes too!
He stopped talking!
He ran out of ideas!
And those tube slides at the water park! The barrel of a rifle and the shell of a bullet! Those are tubes. Oh, there's a tube with a serious crack. And it's also dripping and hissing.
It's dripping? Where?
How can I show you when you kick me out of class?
What's going on?
Take a look. That tube up there is leaking.
That's acid dripping out.
Is that dangerous? It's awful.
Any second now, it'll explode.
Where did Professor Eugenius go?
He went to eat a sandwich.
So what do we do? It's a disaster.
Don't panic. Fire, Verda. Go to that hose and shut off that valve. Simka, go get a pack-a-mat. We'll fix this pipe ourselves. It's very important to be sure that a pipe won't leak. But making pipes that won't leak isn't so easy. Pipes can be made by rolling up a sheet of metal and sealing it up. Unfortunately, the seam can break, and that's why people have figured out how to make pipes without seams. They do it by stretching out hot metal on special machines. And PVC pipes are squeezed out of hot plastic like pasta. When the plastic is cooled down, it hardens into a pipe. We fixed it just in time. Nolik, way to go there. Hey, Simka, where is he?
Don't know. Heh, he finally left.
Here I am.
Nolik, I want to thank you for being alert. And I'd like you to join our class.
Tadish!
Only don't forget, In my class, students cannot answer unless they're called on. Now then, pipes and tubing. Digit, please continue. Well?
But Nolik said all of them already.
Nolik.
Not all. A straw for drinking a shake is a tube. And some noodles are tubes made out of dough. And what's it called? That thing. A hole in a mountain.
Wait a second, I'll get it. A volcano.
That's not it. They go this way. I mean the kind that go like that.
Heh, they're tunnels.
You got it. Well done there.
Yeah. GPS.
And three, four.
Stop. Who goes next?
I'm next.
Five.
One, two, three. Three.
And?
Wait, I gotta choose a route. Should I go here or there?
Choose already. Nolik, what are you doing over there?
Nothing at all. Just waiting at my place.
Good. And don't get off it. Wellfire?
What was that?
The alarm on my Fixie tab. Oh, our lesson's about to start. Hurry!
What about the game?
Later!
As soon as young Fixies enter their first year of Fixie school, everyone gets their own Fixie tab. It's a little computer that can do anything at all. Well, almost anything at all. Studying with a Fixie tab is fantastic. You can read it just like a book and write in it just like writing in a notebook. You can use a Fixie tab to listen to music, watch movies, find your way around, and talk, text, and send letters to your friends. And if you want, you can use a Fixie tab to go on to the internet that humans use, or you can visit the secret Fixie internet, where you can find news about the world of the Fixies. And Fixie tabs have games on them, too. Of course, these games can be a lot of fun, but you shouldn't play games until your homework is all done.
Faster, or we'll be late!
I know a shortcut we can use. This way.
Now which way do we go?
I need to remember the route. I think it's this way. Or it could be that way.
Well, which is it? This or that?
I have no clue.
Uh-huh.
So what's our plan?
We'll go back and start again. We flew in from there, right?
No, I think it was there.
That's not how we flew in. It was there.
I think we're lost in here.
Uh-oh.
Nolik, stop the panicking.
I only went, uh-oh. I'm not panicking yet.
It's your fault, Fire.
I know a shortcut. Go this way.
How are we gonna get out of here?
How do I know? All I know is that we're late for our lesson. Thanks to someone.
It wasn't on purpose, I swear.
Now Grandpa's will punish us.
What's going on?
Well, I think I found a way to get out.
Which way?
Right here. I forgot that inside of my Fixie tab is a GPS navigator.
Class. What's a navigator?
A GPS navigator is an interactive electronic map that can help you find your way around. The navigator can figure out where you are by using signals that are sent to it from satellites. All you have to do is type the address of the place you want to go into it, and the GPS can figure out a route to get you there. And then it helps you as you go by telling you where and when you need to turn, so you can easily get to your destination. Let's see. Right now, we're here.
And where do we need to go?
You know where, to school.
But where is that?
Are you joking? In the laboratory of Professor Eugenius.
Can you be quiet?
Where do you want to go?
The laboratory of Professor Eugenius.
Please wait while I chart out the route.
It did it! The navigator says to go there. Hey, what are you doing over there? Come on!
Thank you.
And if you happen to go off route, the navigator will give you a different way to... Well, you finally made it. Unfortunately, you missed an important lesson today.
We got lost. Forgive us.
In case you're wondering, we were studying navigators.
And you know what? We just used a navigator to get here.
Yeah, it showed us the way we had to go.
Well, that's certainly quite lucky for you, because now you don't get an F. But from now on, kids, you have to get here on time.
I promise you that, because now we know where to get our shortcuts from.
The Talking Doll.
Mama.
Well then, now you know what you need to do to fix it.
Professor? Professor?
Our lesson is over.
I'm sorry to be a bother.
No problem, Professor Eugenius. Our lesson's over.
I've got an urgent matter. You see...
Mama, only that.
You've got yourself a talking doll.
Yes, only she speaks Japanese. The problem is I've been asked to get her to talk in English.
We can teach her.
It's a new technology. I'm puzzled.
Don't you worry. We'll figure it out, Professor.
Thank you, my colleague. You're always there when I need it. What would I do without you?
Professor, can you tell us how toys talk?
Not now, children. We'll learn about the doll tomorrow. Now it's time to go home.
I already know everything about that doll.
You do?
Changing her voice is so easy that anyone can do it.
How?
Here, come, I'll show you. Talking dolls used to work with a noisemaker inside. When the doll was turned over, air inside the noisemaker got pushed through a squeaker at the end of it, making a noise that sounded like the word mama.
Mama.
Funny. Today, the noises are recorded onto an electronic chip that's part of a little player inside of the doll. Just press a button, and the sounds start playing. So now dolls can say much more than just mommy or daddy. They can say anything at all. Well, here's the chip. This is where the recording of the doll's voice is.
That's awesome. Can you re-record the voice on there?
Well, yeah. Okay, I gotta go.
See ya. Wait, Nolik, I thought of a really funny joke to pull. What if we slept them and then we thought and it was a thing?
Uh-huh.
Well, now, as I promised yesterday, I'm going to tell you all about talking dolls. Some start talking when you rock them, while others react to noise. And for this little lady, you need to press a button to get her to talk. Who wants to?
Doula.
Me? Well, okay. I can do it.
Go ahead. And you'll hear her say, "Hi there, Mama." But in Japanese for now.
Doula? Is that Japanese for hi there?
Doula! Why are you hiding a picture of Digit in an alpaca mat?
How could she ever know that?
Maybe you're in love?
That doll is alive!
They call that joking.
I just thought of a better joke that we can play.
Yeah.
What?
Doula, don't cry. She's not alive.
She is alive.
I'll tell you who did this horrible thing. It was Fire and Nolik.
Huh?
It's true, but now the joke will be on them.
How?
It's easy. All we gotta do is go.
The smartest Fixie in our class is Digit. Sometimes I think that he knows everything about everything. Professor Grandpus has a lot of respect for him. Digit's always in thought whenever you see him, and he doesn't like when anyone distracts him. He just has no time for fooling around with the other boys. Digit prefers to solve problems using his brains and not his muscles. That's why he can have a tough time in gym class. But he's so sweet that it makes you want to help him. To tell you the truth, Digit isn't always great fixing things with his own hands.
But no one understands technology better than he does. If something breaks, Digit can always figure out exactly what's wrong with it and the very best way to fix it.
We're gonna make it even funnier this time.
Uh-huh.
You came back?
What?
You troublemakers. Now I'll show you what happens to bad boys who hurt girls' feelings.
Oh, you got scared.
Who's crying now, huh?
They probably thought that the doll came to life.
You know what, Digit? I just started thinking that it might be better if she were alive.
You know, Tula, you sure are hard to please.
The drum. Now, let's turn it on. It's buzzing. You hear it?
I would love to. But the only thing I can hear is Nolik's banging.
Nolik, what are you doing?
I'm rehearsing my solo.
Nolik's the drummer in our rock band. Didn't you know that?
Why don't you go and rehearse somewhere else if you wouldn't mind?
Yeah, all right.
I just can't work like this.
Nolik, stop it, please. Oh, my head is just splitting.
Professor Eugenius, will you come to the laboratory? There's something very strange in there.
What?
I'm hearing some kind of awful sound.
You are?
I think it's a ghost. Back from the dead.
Don't you worry about ghosts, Lisa. I'll check what it is. So it's you making the racket.
What? I'm just rehearsing.
Well, what is it?
Don't worry. It's just a piece of equipment rattling. You know what you should do? You should go and practice back at home, my young friend.
It's not very hard to make a drum. One way to make it is to take an empty barrel and replace its bottom with a skin made of leather or plastic. If the skin is stretched tightly, the sound can get very bright and loud. Really big drums are usually played with percussion mallets or beaters, while smaller drums can be played with sticks or with bare hands. Instruments that make sounds by being shaken, scraped, or beaten are all called percussion instruments. There are lots of different percussion instruments, like the small hand drums that are called bongos, big shakers with handles called maracas, cymbals made out of metal. Now, those really make a lot of noise. And there's tambourines, ratchets, and even spoons. That's right! People can make music using spoons as a percussion instrument.
Tom Thomas, do you think I could practice my drumming here?
Yeah. Go ahead. I've just got some homework to do. I can do that, and better than you can, too.
And what if I play like this, huh?
Then I'll go like that, or like that.
Bang it, bang it, bang it, boom, bang it, boom, bang it, 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 bang it
drum!
Stop! That's enough!
Bang the drum!
And now, let's turn it off. Can you hear that? It stopped buzzing.
It did. Hey, everybody, it's Nolik. Yo, what's up?
So, our noisy ghost is back.
I thought you were practicing at home now.
Tom Thomas is drumming there. I had to run away.
Well, our excursion is over. And now I would just be so happy to listen to your rock group.
Hooray!
The barcode.
And so, what do we do if we happen to see humans?
Hide from them, right?
And what if you've got nowhere to hide?
Then we turn ourselves into screws.
That's correct.
Where could it be? Where on earth could I have put it? Oh, I'm such a scatterbrain.
Ah, it's Professor Eugenius. There's no need to hide from him. He's our friend.
Where has it gone?
Did you lose something again, Professor?
Yeah, how did you guess? It's just awful. Yesterday I started testing a new iron, and today, it's totally disappeared into thin air.
Where could you have put that thing?
I've got it down to two places. It could be in the warehouse or... not in the warehouse.
Yeah, that information will help us find it.
Or not help us find it.
Class, follow me to the warehouse.
Wow, look at all these boxes.
If we have to look inside each one of them, it'll take us 2 days.
Maybe we'll get lucky. Let's look in this one.
No! Inside there is a fan.
A fan? Wow, it's a fan.
And what's inside this one?
A mixer.
Yeah, amazing.
And what's in this box?
An electric kettle. Made in Germany, by the way.
He's right. There is a kettle in there.
Professor? Is this some trick? I don't get it.
Grandpus, how do you do it?
It's gotta be magic. What else?
Here's how I think he's doing it. I think the professor has glasses made to see through the boxes.
Of course not. I only know how to read the barcode that you can see on each of those boxes.
Oh, that.
Exactly. If you look at the printing on packages and boxes, you will often find a symbol with a lot of black lines and numbers. These symbols are called barcodes. Each barcode has all sorts of information. What the item is, what country it came from, and even in which factory it was made. With the help of a special reading device, a scanner, it's possible to read all the information the barcode holds. It really is an excellent system for stores to know what they've got.
You don't even need a scanner to do it?
I can figure out barcodes without one. I'll teach you if you want.
Class.
Let's see. We're looking for a box with an iron. There! Well, bring in the professor.
Today, on almost everything that is sold, there is some kind of mark. For instance, this kind of mark is called a barcode. And this one, a QR code. These marks help us find out a lot of information. Suppose you walk by a building and see a QR code on it. Just point the camera on your mobile phone at it, and information about who built it and when it was built will appear on the screen. Isn't that great? It's a shame not every phone can do this yet. And that's not all. There are also marks that work without pictures. There are electronic chips that can hold information. These chips can be put inside of ID cards or travel passes, and all you need to do is press the card near a reader so it can check if you're allowed to go on through.
Ah, you just made my day. You found it so quickly. What would I do without you? Huh?
Is something wrong?
This is not an iron.
Whose sandwich is that?
Mine. Yesterday I wanted to put it into the fridge, only I guess I put it into my... I just get distracted so easily.
Look, we need to think this through logically. If you went and placed your sandwich into the box where the iron should have gone, then you must have put your iron...
in the refrigerator!
Oh, here you are. Here you are, my new iron. Oh, I looked everywhere for you. Thank you, my friends, once again.
There's no need to thank us at all. You're always there when we need help. You've even let us open our own school here in your laboratory.
And we don't have to hide ourselves.
Yeah, that's because you're so kind and you love Fixies.
The clocks. Go around. Left side.
That's crazy. You'll crash.
No, I won't. See, I told ya.
What?
Huh? Nothing.
Now you talk with your computer like it's your friend.
Listen, that's enough playing for today.
Oh, Mom, just a little more. I'll give you half an hour while I cook dinner, and that'll be enough for today with the computer.
This stinks. I'll never get through all of these levels in half an hour.
No way. Hey, but what if we could stretch out the half hour?
How?
We could take the hands on the clock and move them back a little.
Mom will catch us.
Fine, then let's slow down the speed of the clock.
Yeah,
but how?
She gotta know things like that. Since olden times, many clocks run with the help of a pendulum. The pendulum controls how fast the hands of the clock turn. If you make it longer, the pendulum will start to swing slower, and the clock's hands will slow down. If you make the pendulum shorter, the clock will tick faster. Most clocks that are made today don't use pendulums. They run with the help of springs or with an electronic chip instead. But even so, there are ways to change the speed of these clocks, too.
Push it!
Wow, you did it! It's amazing how much slower it is.
That'll give you lots of time to play.
But now you gotta slow down the clocks in the kitchen.
Yeah, and every other clock you got. I just have to turn this to make the pendulum longer.
Uh-huh. And now the clock will go slower. Tadish! Fire! Now that clock over there.
Let's go do it.
That's it! We slowed down every clock, and your mom didn't see a thing.
That's great. Yeah, 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 yeah!
Wow, Tom Thomas, you're cool! Amazing!
He got another one!
Awesome!
You're unbelievable! Way to go!
Huh. That's strange.
Hooray!
Incredible!
Yay! I did every level! Oh, thanks! You're both just...
the Time Masters of the Universe!
Yeah, but I'm getting really hungry, and Mom hasn't called me for dinner.
Because a half hour hasn't passed on the clock.
Hey, do you smell that?
Something is burning! What happened? A fire?
I don't get it. I was just waiting for 30 minutes like I always do, but everything burned this time. Maybe the clock stopped?
No, take a look. They're working.
Oh, I'll make you some oatmeal.
Oatmeal for dinner? Mom, I need to, I'll be right back. You see what you've done? Time Masters of the Universe? You gotta go speed those clocks back up.
Okay, okay. We'll speed them up. They'll be caught up in no time.
Humans have come up with lots of different ways to measure time. For example, if you stand a stick in the ground, you can measure the time of day by watching where its shadow falls. That's a very simple clock called a sundial. Another simple and ancient clock is a water clock. It keeps track of time by measuring how much water has poured out of it. And if the clock uses sand instead of water, it's called an hourglass. But humans weren't able to accurately keep track of the time until they invented mechanical clocks. They come in all sorts of sizes, from grandfather clocks to watches worn around the wrist. Today, we also have easy-to-read and accurate electronic watches and clocks. But the most accurate clock of them all is the atomic clock. It tells the entire world the exact time.
Tom Thomas, why is your alarm clock ringing in the middle of the night, huh?
Really? Is it still night out?
Look, Tom Thomas.
But the clock says that it's morning.
Interesting.
Yesterday, Fire and I sped up all the clocks, so that's the reason the alarm went off.
Sped them up? Are you crazy?
Tom Thomas asked us.
So what do we have to do now?
Don't you know? Get to school, it's time. I'm joking. Whew. Go back to sleep. Don't worry, I'll get all the clocks working right again.
Can I go and fix them with you?
Ha, fix them? You boys are the ones that always make the problems.
The Catapult.
Tom Thomas isn't here. There's no way these toy soldiers could have shot it themselves.
Now that was a good shot.
It wasn't real long, and not high either. And off target. It was pretty awful.
It was good, but awful. I got it. So what do we do?
We need to raise it up a little higher.
Hey, Fire, Nolik! Why in the world would you shoot at a Fixie?
Fixies? They're supposed to be in school right now.
Actually, I'm on my way to school. How about you, Fire? Why aren't you in class?
Because there it's totally boring. But here, look at what a cool shooter we found.
Ha! What did you call it? You've got no idea what this is. It's called a catapult, guys.
A cat with gold eyes?
It isn't a cat with gold eyes. It's a catapult, guys. Catapults are ancient propulsion machines. They were used to shoot stones, heavy arrows, or barrels with burning tar. The main part of the catapult is a special piece of rope. It is twisted very, very tightly, like a spring. The rope is then wrapped around a big spoon. And then, if you pull the spoon back, put a stone in it, and let it go, the catapult fires a shot. Ooh, and the stone flies far, far away.
Uh-huh. All right, so here we go. Ha! Ugh, came up short.
What do you mean short? What are you aiming at?
You'll see. The spoon needs to go further back. Just a little.
Guys, you're gonna break the glass.
Nolik, now push. All right. Yes! Right on target. Now let's fly out into space.
Wait, what space? What kind of flying? Who's gonna fly?
I'm gonna fly. Right out the window. Right up to the moon.
First Fixin' onto the world, Nolik. Are you ready for your flight into space?
Yes, sir.
Nolik, get out of the spoon now.
I'll be the first Fixie on the moon. Yeah!
Nolik, enough of this. What kind of joke is this?
It's not a joke at all. He's gonna fly into space.
And how come it's not you?
Because he's lighter.
Hold on. Humans didn't go straight into space themselves. They sent dogs out there first.
Nah. Chewsaka's not gonna fit in here.
Simka, why don't you go and let us finish?
Fine, I will go. But only after Nolik finds himself a helmet.
You're right about that. I'll go find a helmet.
The catapult was invented in ancient times, but people still use them today. Only now, instead of launching stones, catapults are used to launch jet airplanes. You see, the runway on an aircraft carrier is quite short, so catapults are used to help the planes move fast enough to take off. Catapults can also be used to save the life of a pilot. When an airplane has an accident, A catapult activates in the cabin. The pilot is shot into the sky and comes back to the ground with a parachute. A plain old slingshot is also a kind of catapult. It's just a very little one. But be careful with this toy. It can be dangerous to others and to you too. As for us Fixies, the only time that we use catapults is on a peaceful mission.
Pabus, hurry! Our Nolik's getting shot to the moon with a catapult!
What?
And if I meet new Fixies up there, what should I say to them?
Hi there. And you can ask them to launch you back. So?
Let's do it! Fire! Launch it!
Stop! Don't! Simka! Nolik!
I'm not getting out!
Whew! We're alive!
Hooray! He flew all the way!
Who flew away?
To the moon?
Nope, just a bit short.
It's not our fault. You're just heavier than Nolik, and that's why you came up short.
Pappus, maybe we can try one more time.
What?
The chain reaction.
Tom Thomas, what you doing?
Nolik, leave me alone.
No, really. What is that?
Quit distracting me, will you? Nolik, look at what you've done.
I?
It's all because you wouldn't quit it.
Wouldn't quit what?
I was struggling with that thing for half an hour and you ruined it. Ugh.
You always have to be fussing over everybody.
Come on, why are you so angry, huh?
Nolik was rude to me.
That means you have to be rude to me?
Forgive me, Tula.
And where is Nolik right now?
There.
Let's go see him. Nolik, it's Tula. Are you all right?
I'm fine.
Why were you so rude with your sister?
'Cause Tom Thomas was rude with me.
I get it. It's a chain reaction.
A what?
Setting a log on fire isn't easy. But it's easy to light a match. Use the match to light kindling, the kindling to light a twig, and the twig to light the log. Have you ever seen a fire grow? It's an example of a typical chain reaction. So be extra careful with fire. Because just one match or little piece of smoldering coal can lead to a huge disaster. Yes, they can make a whole forest burst into flame and burn down to the ground. And all because of a simple chain reaction.
I don't get you. What chain reaction?
What do you mean, Nolik? Tom Thomas was rude to you, then you were rude to Simka, then Simka was rude with me.
So there it is, a chain reaction.
Yeah, and the rudeness was like a little spark. It just spread and spread and spread like a forest fire.
Will you forgive me, Simka? Yeah, all right.
I've got an idea. Why don't we try starting our very own chain reaction the other way around?
What do you mean?
Well, instead of spreading angry and rude feelings, we could spread happiness.
But how?
It's simple. All we need to do is smile and say nice things to each other.
What a great idea! We could work together and fix Tom Thomas's mood. And I know how. Come help me pick up this domino, will you?
Everything in the whole universe is made up of atoms. particles so extremely small that you can't even see them through a microscope. But when a tiny atom splits, it makes a tiny explosion. And that explosion can start another explosion, and another explosion, and another. And now you've got a chain reaction. And that's how a lot of tiny explosions work together to make the gigantic explosion of an atomic bomb, the deadliest weapon known to man. But atomic energy can also be used for peaceful purposes. For example, nuclear power plants use this energy to produce electricity and hot water. And nuclear-powered icebreakers can break through the thick Arctic ice so ships can sail on their way.
They're all done.
Nolik, bring them in.
And now we're gonna teach Tom Thomas how a chain reaction can work to make you feel really good.
He's coming. On your marks, now.
What's going on? No, really?
Tom Thomas, watch this.
I can't believe what I saw. How did you do that? It was just a real...
A chain reaction.
What?
A chain reaction.
Modeling clay.
All done. Simka, take a look. I've got my own... Pack-a-mat.
Now look at that, a pack-a-mat made out of modeling clay.
But this one's my own, and it looks just like a real one.
Okay, you're right, it really does, Nolik.
Simka, Nolik, what's up?
Hi there, Fire.
Wanna play some tag with me?
I really wish I could play tag, but unlike you, I've got tons of work.
Yeah, like what?
Well, a bathroom hook fell down. Tom Thomas broke the lamp on his desk. The aquarium has a tube that's leaking. So go and play. I have to get a pack-a-mat.
Oh, oh, oh.
I wish I could play tag.
Hold on. Nolik, you've got a pack-a-mat.
Uh-huh.
Although I gotta say, it looks a little strange.
That's because it's...
Let's fix everything before Simka. With your pack-a-mat and my Fixie board. This'll be great. So where is that hook that fell down? All right. Nolik, get out some sticky stuff.
From where?
Obviously, from out of your pack-a-mat.
But it isn't real. I made it out of modeling clay today.
Out of clay? Well, it totally looks real.
Long ago, back in the Stone Age, people learned how to use clay to make their dishes and sculptures. But the modeling clay that we use nowadays was only invented about 100 years ago. Actually, modeling clay is just plain old clay with some ingredients added so it won't dry out. And dyes are mixed in to make all the different colors. There is just no end to all of the fun things you can make out of modeling clay.
I got an idea. Go on, turn around.
What are you doing?
Grabbing glue out of your pack-a-mat. All right, get up here.
Will it stick?
Yeah, of course it will. Let's go and fix the lamp.
We can't fix this without a real pack-a-mat.
Yours will work just fine. So, what else did Simka have to fix?
The aquarium!
Hop on! Well, where's that leaky tube?
Here! It's leaking at the joint!
Yeah, this tube is gonna need a lot of modeling clay. Give me the rest of your pack-a-mat.
Sure!
And here's a souvenir.
Hmm.
They're all done.
What's
that's all done.
We already fixed everything.
And what did you fix it with?
Modeling clay.
Ha! Modeling clay isn't gonna hold anything.
Well, I say it will.
Wanna bet?
All right.
What in the world is happening here?
Flooding water!
You just do as I tell you, without panicking. Did you know it's possible to make modeling clay in your own home? Just write down this recipe. You'll need a cup of flour, a half a cup of salt, and a half a cup of water. Now, mix the salt with the flour and add the water little by little. Mix it together really well. What are you saying? That it looks just like dough? Well, that's exactly what it is. It's just not for eating. It's way too salty. But you certainly can sculpt things out of it. If you want your modeling clay to be colorful, you can add food coloring or watercolors to it. That's it. Your modeling clay is ready to be sculpted. When you're finished, don't forget to let your figures dry in the sun. That way they'll get nice and hard and last you a very long time. We almost didn't make it.
And did you fix the lamp with that modeling clay?
Uh-huh.
And the hook, too. That was not a good idea.
But it was really quick.
Hey, that's true. That's why I want to give a medal to you. You're heroes.
For real?
Of course you are. And here it is. Your medal.
But it's made out of modeling clay.
Your reward fits your heroic deed.
The prosthesis.
Simka, over here. Take a look at what I found. It's a bear.
Ooh. What bear did you find, Nolik?
You know, it's the one Tom Thomas told us about. He was his best friend in the whole wide world. Until he became friends with you and me.
What? Uh-huh. Let's try to wind him up. Come on, come on, come on. There you go. Now walk, Teddy. Go on, Teddy. Yeah. Oh. Oh, no. Poor little teddy bear. They ripped his leg and didn't care.
We didn't rip his leg. It was already broken.
It's all clear. A compound fracture.
Then why don't we fix him? Tom Thomas will be so happy.
Wait, it's not going to be that easy to repair it. We'll need a prosthesis. The human body is built around a frame of bones and joints. And if you break one of the bones, it'll usually heal by itself. The broken bone will grow back together, and you'll be back to normal. But sometimes bones or joints can break so badly that it's impossible for them to heal. When this happens, they have to be replaced with an artificial part called a prosthesis. A prosthesis can replace more than a bone or a joint. It can be made to replace a whole arm or a leg.
And where are we gonna get a prosthesis?
I'm positive we can get it from Professor Eugenius.
You're right.
Help is on the way!
Hello! Professor Eugenius!
Ah, I'm pleased to see you, dear children. How do you do?
Hi there!
Professor Eugenius, can you make a prosthesis?
What, have you broken something?
No, not us. It was the bear. He broke his leg.
What bear?
The teddy bear that used to be Tom Thomas's friend.
Ah, now I see.
Today, with the help of modern prosthetics, more is being replaced than just arms and legs. For example, if you lose a tooth, it can be replaced with an artificial one. That's also a prosthesis. And there are times when a person starts losing their vision because the lens in their eye gets foggy and can't focus. For this, there's another kind of prosthesis, a new clear artificial lens. A prosthesis can also be used to help people with poor hearing. A tiny device can be put inside of somebody's ear so they can hear what's going on. And that's not all. People have also learned how to treat a sick heart by replacing its worn-out parts with prostheses. What fantastic inventions these prostheses are! It's amazing what they can do. They help people live a full life.
Professor, is it working out?
We'll know soon enough. Done. Here you go.
Thanks so much for your help, Professor Eugenius.
Not at all. Take care, kids.
In gadgets and devices, our work will never end. Appliances are fickle. They need a loyal friend.
At morning, noon, and midnight of every single day, when there is an emergency, you know we're on our way. One, two, three. Inside will be all day and night. We fix things right.
Well, now this old friend of Tom Thomas's will be just like new, Nolik.
Simka, if Tom Thomas makes friends with the bear, then what? Will he stop being friends with us?
Hi, everybody.
Hi there.
Oh, my teddy bear. You found him for me. And you fixed him. Ah, thanks a lot.
It's just like Grandpa said. A friend that's old is better than two that are new.
Who's new and who's old?
Well, the bear is old.
And we're new.
Nolik, it's not true. You're the Fixies, guys. You're my very, very best friends in the whole wide world.
Tadish!
The Pack-a-Mat.
Simka. Can I have the Pack-a-Mat? I'd like to practice with it a little before the exam.
Take it! You're really good with that thing.
Good. I couldn't be any worse with it. I wanted a vacuum cleaner.
Actually, you were pretty close there. You did manage to get the hose, at least.
This is not at all funny.
To get a tool out of a Pack-a-Mat, a Fixie must not only press the button on his chest, but he must also clearly picture exactly the tool he needs. By the time they are adults, this is easy for Fixies to do. But while they're children, they must study hard to master this important skill. As Fixies learn about new tools, they take exams to prove they know how they work. And if they pass an exam, the new tool is added to their Pack-a-Mats. And there's no end to what you can find inside. Screwdrivers, hammers, ladders, vacuums, and even soldering irons. But many of the tools that Fixies use look quite different from the ones that humans have. And the reason for this is very simple. It's because Fixies have to fix appliances that are much bigger than they are.
I just wish I knew which tool was gonna be on that exam.
I got it! You just stay right here! Grandpus!
What?
On the exam, which tool are you gonna ask about?
It's a secret.
It's too bad.
But I'm sure you can keep a secret, right?
Of course!
Then I'll tell you. Today's exam is on pliers, you see? You won't tell anyone, will you?
Not a chance.
I'll never pass it.
You will! He's gonna ask about pliers.
Huh? How could you know that?
It's a secret. Okay, Digit. See if you can get the pliers out of there.
A pair of pliers is a great tool indeed. To grab and turn things, it's the tool that you need. Just be careful how you use them. Or your fingers, you could bruise them. Pliers are careful how you use them, or your fingers, you could bruise them. Pliers are a great tool indeed.
Good going. You got it.
Thanks a lot, Nolik.
It's not really me you should be thanking.
what?
The secret.
What secret?
About the pliers.
Oh, that. You know, I picked a new topic. I decided that a hammer won't be the tool.
A hammer?
Only it's a secret.
I remember. The topic got changed. It's a hammer.
You sure about that?
Totally.
All right. I'll try to do it.
A hammer is a great tool indeed. To pound in nails, it is the tool that you need. Just be careful how you use it, or your finger you could bruise it. A hammer is a great tool indeed.
Super! I'm sure you're gonna pass.
That's only if he asks me about a hammer.
I'll be right back! Krampus, it's a hammer for sure?
Nah. A hammer would be way too easy for those kids. So now it is a drill.
A drill?
But only...
It's a secret! Now I know. There's no doubt about it at all. It's a drill!
A drill is such a great tool indeed. To drill a hole, it is the tool that you need.
Just be careful how you use it, or your finger you could lose it. A drill is such a great tool indeed.
And if it's not a drill?
Right!
Hammers, wrenches, drills, screwdrivers, vices, mallets, saws, and pliers. All of these are super duper great tools, yes indeed.
That's all. That's enough of this. I'll just go and take the exam. Yeah.
Digit, come on in.
Professor, well, what do you want to ask me on today's exam?
Nothing. You already passed.
What? You mean you're not going to ask me anything at all?
No need. You're excellent at getting tools out of a pack-a-mat.
But how could you know that?
That's a secret. And we Fixies sure know how to keep secrets. 20,
20, the armor. 22,
23, 24, 25. Ready or not, here we come.
I heard him. He ran into the hallway. You check the kitchen, Nolik, and I'll check the living room.
Well, I just don't get it. Where could he be hiding?
The office. We forgot to check in there.
For him to hide.
Inside the shark.
Nolik, Tom Thomas couldn't even fit half of himself inside of that shark.
Yeah? Then in that huge vase.
Uh-huh. He's all scrunched up in there and laughing at us.
Oh! Simka! There! Did you hear that? He is in there! There's no one, but I know that I heard a hee-hee.
You imagined it. Let's go take a look in the bathroom.
I imagined it.
Whew. It's so stuffy inside this armor. The arms got stuck.
Where else could he be?
Who is that?
Ah! Simka the knife! He came to life!
Well, how much longer are you gonna look for me?
Armor is very hard clothing worn by warriors to protect them against swords and arrows. People started making armor in ancient times, but the full body armor that knights wore didn't start until the Middle Ages. The armor worn by knights on horses was heavy. It could weigh 100 pounds, and if a knight got knocked off of his horse, he'd need help to get back up again. By the way, the knights' horses, they wore their own heavy set of armor for protection.
Hey, did you turn into statues?
Tom Thomas? Is that you in there?
Who else? Lift up this visor, I can barely breathe.
And how come we should do it?
'Cause I can't. Don't you see? My arms got stuck.
We see. You look funny.
Funny to you, but now I'm stuck and I can't get out of here. Come on, help me out, please.
Great, Chewsaka's just what we need right now.
Chewsaka, what's wrong with you? It's me. Hey, stop it. Help, I can't get up.
Come on, let's undo the latches, Nolik, quickly.
Ooh, thanks for helping me.
It was nothing.
I couldn't have done it without you.
Let's put the night back together.
Uh-huh. Before Dad gets back.
Protective clothing isn't just for people who are fighting in battles. Travelers put on special nets to protect themselves against mosquitoes and gnats. And beekeepers wear protective clothes, too. If they had nothing to protect them from bee stings, their job would be quite painful. Without their protective clothing, it would be impossible for firefighters to go into burning buildings and save people. And how could astronauts go into outer space without special clothing? It's freezing up there and there's no air to breathe at all. And that's why they wear a special costume called a spacesuit when they travel. The spacesuit not only protects astronauts from the cold, but supplies them with air so they can breathe. By the way, the Fixies also wear protective clothing so they can stay safe while they work.
Well, there. Did we get it right?
It looks like we got it right.
Only, where's the helmet?
Nolik went to get it.
Dom Thomas! Helmet delivery!
Thanks there, Chewsaka.
Whoa there, Warhorse. Calm yourself down.
There we go. It's all back in place again.
Too bad that your knight looks like a ballerina twirling around.
You see, his arm. I can't move it. It's stuck.
Here's what we'll do. Give him something to hold.
Well, how's that look?
Perfect. Now we can paddle into battle.
The camera.
Stop right there and let me see how pretty you look today.
Well, just don't tell that to the elevator.
Bye-bye.
Check it out, Nolik. Class, huh?
You're not gonna get in trouble for doing that?
No. My dad gave me permission to take a few pictures with this camera.
No, I mean the picture. You're sure that your mom and dad will like that you took it without asking for permission?
But look, what a good picture.
You know what, Tom Thomas? You're like a regular paparazzi or something.
Paparazzi? They're the ones that take one photo and get millions, aren't they?
You're right. And don't care about anyone except their photo paparazzis. Did you ever wonder how a photo camera works? Let's say you want to take a picture of nature. The light that's outside goes into the camera's lens. That's the glass eye on the front of the camera. The lens takes the light from the scene outside the camera and turns it into a tiny picture that's inside the camera. Then the picture is recorded onto a special electronic sensor called a matrix that's sensitive to light. Click, and there's your photo.
What a great idea! Now I know! I'm going to be a paparazzi!
Hey, what about your promise?
What promise?
To never take a picture of us!
We're a secret! Stop!
Hey, relax. I'll delete them all later.
Tom Thomas, stop this right now!
I won't until I get a photo of you.
Nolik, let's run!
You can't run from me.
Chewsaka?
Aha! I've gotcha!
the story of the century, the monster and its prey.
Tom Thomas! Help! No, he won't help, because he's a paparazzi.
Yes, I got it. That's my best photo yet.
What's all this noise about?
Awesome shot.
The first cameras were invented almost 200 years ago, but they worked very slowly. If you wanted to have your portrait taken, you'd have to sit still for a whole hour. After film was invented, cameras got much faster, and it became possible to take about 10 pictures a minute. On a piece of film, everything appears to be backwards. Black parts of the picture are white, and the white is black. It doesn't look normal until the picture is transferred from the film to a piece of photographic paper. Now people shoot pictures with digital cameras that work without any film at all. You can look at what you shot instantly on a screen to see if you like it. And if you don't like it, you can try shooting another one. And today, you don't even need a separate camera to take pictures. Almost every mobile phone has one.
Simka and Nolik, are you in there? Hey, come out. I'll stop shooting photos of you. Aren't we friends? I'm sorry, guys.
Well, your friends were almost eaten alive by a dog.
Please forgive me. Wanna look at the photos I took?
Sure, go on, show us what you got. We're not in that shot. We're not there either. Well done there, paparazzi.
Hang on a sec. I still got another one and you're in it. I know for sure. Look. I'm zooming in. It's impossible. I don't believe it.
It's possible.
But when did you have time to turn into screws?
The same time you were pushing the button.
When we're scared, we can change faster than the blink of an eye.
You lost, paparazzi.
And what are you gonna do with your millions, Mr. Paparazzi?
Would you please stop calling me that?
You got it, after every one of those photos is thrown away.
All right, I'll delete them. And do I have to delete this one, too?
No, keep it. It's a great shot. I never even saw you take it.
The disguise.
Ugh, good.
Tom Thomas, why do you need a second aquarium? Especially without any fish.
First of all, it's a terrarium. And it's not for fish, it's for lizards and snakes.
Ooh.
My friend Katya asked me to take care of him while she's away. That's why I brought him here.
Take care of who? There's no one in there.
Ah! What is that?
It's a chameleon, Nolik. I think he's awesome.
It's a bad idea to take him out. He might run away.
Don't you worry. I got him.
What a monster. But how come I couldn't see him before?
It's because a chameleon knows how to disguise himself by changing the color of his whole body. Have you ever seen a military uniform? They have special patterns and colors that help soldiers hide. That's called camouflage, and people learned it from animals. For instance, a caterpillar can look like a twig, and a seahorse can look like a piece of coral. An ordinary gray rabbit becomes white in the winter, so a wolf will have trouble finding it in the snow. But the champion of camouflage is the chameleon. This master of disguise can change its color in just a matter of seconds.
Hey, Tom Thomas, where'd your chameleon go?
Oh, it disappeared.
It didn't disappear, it camouflaged.
He won't hide for long. Let's find him.
Chewsaka, have you seen the chameleon? Where is he? Do you see him?
No, he's not gonna let us catch him.
We're gonna have to trick him into coming to us.
Uh-huh. We can set a trap with something that he likes.
What do they like, I wonder?
What else? Their food.
And what do chameleons eat?
Well, like flies or caterpillars, roaches.
Where's the fly gonna come from?
Well, what if...
What? Ooh, Simka, just you wait. I'm gonna get you.
Hey, we gotta help Katya. You don't see the caterpillar complaining.
Quiet. Nolik, you start buzzing.
Buzzing?
Yeah, like a fly.
Yeah, and flap your wings, too.
Simka, how long do I gotta keep doing this?
Until the chameleon shows himself. Just keep buzzing.
Tom Thomas! There he is! Grab him!
Camouflage all the time. They use nets that look like bushes, paint their tanks in colors that make them blend into their surroundings, and even fly in special planes that can't be seen by radar. They do everything they can to disguise their location. But it's not just the army that uses disguises. Photographers camouflage themselves to take pictures of wild animals. People use makeup to camouflage their blemishes. And artists, they disguise old walls with bright, happy pictures. And people just love to put on masquerade parties where they disguise themselves in costumes and masks. And of course, Fixies have their own great disguise. Remember? Well, what is it?
Now he won't run away.
So, Mr. Master of Disguise, what are you gonna say now?
If only I could disguise myself that well.
Nolik, what are you talking about? You know how to disguise yourself 100 times better than him.
Ah, you're right. Hey, chameleon, look and learn. Here's a real disguise.
The globe.
Ready? Set?
Go!
Yay! Again, I couldn't do it.
I told you, there's just no way to hold on when the globe is turning that fast.
But I know I can do it. Give me that piece of rope there, would you? Now you can't throw me off. Spin it.
Go on.
Whoa!
What you doing? Trying to learn a bit about the Earth's gravity?
That's a globe, not the Earth.
Well, a globe's a model of the Earth, isn't it?
Hey, come on, Simka. The globe looks like a ball, but the Earth is flat. We walk on it.
The Earth also looks like a ball. It's just a very, very big one.
It's not true. If the Earth is really round like you say, then it would throw people right off of it, like the globe does to me.
No, it's just that the Earth pulls everyone towards it.
Are you sure?
The planet that we live on, the Earth, is a huge sphere. The Earth revolves around the Sun, and the Moon revolves around the Earth. Do you know why they don't fly away from each other? It's because of a force called gravity that pulls all objects towards each other. The heavier the object, the stronger its pull. That's why people, rocks, air, and water get pulled towards the Earth instead of floating up into space. Thanks to gravity, we are able to walk on the Earth.
Then why doesn't the globe pull
on me like the Earth does.
Because this globe is very light. Compared to the Earth, this globe is like millions of billions of times lighter.
Compared to the Earth, we're specks of dust.
He's right. Look, a speck of dust. It sticks to the globe like we stick to the Earth.
Oh, come on. It's just because no one's turning it.
But the Earth's spinning and we stick to it.
What? I just don't believe you. There's just no way the Earth is spinning.
You've really got no idea how the days all turn into the nights, do you?
Do too. It's because the sun goes up and then sets.
Watch this. Our sun's here and you're over there. On Earth. Is it dark, Nolik?
It's dark.
Then it's nighttime on your side.
And here, it's day.
All right. Now we'll turn the Earth.
Hooray! Now it's daytime for me.
And night for me over here.
Ah, my side got dark again.
And for me, it's a new day.
All right, fine. You guys were right. I believe you.
The Earth is spinning.
The Earth goes round and round like a tilted spinning top. And as it spins, the sun shines its light on whichever half of the Earth is facing it. And as the Earth makes one full turn, we watch how the night becomes day and the day becomes night again. It takes 24 hours for the Earth to make one full turn. But that's not all. The Earth is also traveling in space around the sun. It takes the Earth 1 year to make a full circle. As it goes along its way, the top and bottom of the Earth take turns being closer to the sun. That's because the Earth is tilted. When the top half is closer to the sun, it's summer there, while at the very same time on the bottom half, it is winter. And when it is winter on the top half, it is summer on the bottom.
Nolik. Nolik, where are you?
I'm not sure. Somewhere in Kazakhstan. The force of gravity is super strong around here. So go on, spin it.
You're gonna fall off, Nolik.
Don't worry, just do it. Go ahead and tilt it if you feel like it. Told ya! Ha! And you were sure I was gonna fall off this globe.
That's strange. Nolik, come on over here.
What for?
You'll see in a second.
I don't want to.
You really don't want or you can't. Tom Thomas, take a look.
I get it. He stuck himself to the globe, didn't he?
Yeah, with the chewing gum. Isn't it time to go?
Uh-huh.
And me! Well, what about me? Hey! You gotta help me! Don't leave me!
Should we help him?
But the pull of chewing gum is even stronger than the Earth's gravity.